Hey guys. All right, so I'm filming this after the fact because I had to go pick up my daughter from preschool. My son didn't nap. It was a really crazy afternoon, but I totally flaked. We are at over 100 subscribers on this channel. So I want to say thank you to everybody who has subscribed, everybody who's new, coming back, having fun, enjoying the podcast. Thank you so much for your support. So as a reward, I'm opening up a thread in my Ravelry group. So check the links down below. You can search Littlebean and Me podcast on the groups Ravelry groups tab. But I'm going to give away a special prize, So I want you to answer me this question. What is your favorite season? Mine is the fall. I love the fall. It is far and away my favorite season. I'm a fall, then a spring, then a summer, then a winter kind of person. So I love the fall. So I want to know, what is your favorite season? Go to the Ravelry group, click the link in the doop-de-doop-de-doop down below and answer me that question. I'm going to leave this open for one full week, which means it will close on the 30th. On the 30th. Shall we say that? It'll close on the 30th when I get up. I'm not going to stay up all night to close it. When I wake up on the 30th, I'm going to go close the tab and then we'll draw a winner. I have an interrupter. I got to go. Stay tuned for a cool podcast. Bye. Guys, welcome back to my channel. First thing, my son is upstairs for a nap and he may or may not sleep. We'll see. And so you may hear him on the monitor over here where you can't see him. And so the other thing is the windows are open, so you might hear some cars going back and forth. And then the last thing is you'll notice I'm sitting in my living room. I thought I would change it up a little bit since I've moved my schedule to Fridays. This is a little bit more of a comfortable setting for me. My toddler's not around, so I'm not worried about the TV being on or anything like that. So I can just sit here and film. I used to film in my living room. On my other channel, I have a personal channel that I was making some mom-related videos on. And I was sitting here in my living room, and this is very comfortable. The coffee table right here, got really good lighting, I got the couch behind me, I can show little things that I'm doing behind me, so I thought I would change it up. So I hope you enjoy this little setting here. Anyway, so with all that out of the way, welcome back to my channel. This is the Little Bean and Me podcast. My name's Kayleen. I am your host, and I am the principal fiber artist and yarn dyer behind Little Bean Crochet, and Little Bean loves hand-painted yarn, which you'll see right here. And I am all over social media, have a couple different names. You can find me as Little Bean Crochet on Instagram, Little Bean Crochet Shop on Facebook, and as KM Weaver on Ravelry, like M as in Marie, Kayleen Marie. And I'll also put it up here on the screen. And then you can also find me on Etsy. My shop is littlebeancrochet.etsy.com. Okay, so that's all out of the way. Welcome if you're a new viewer. I hope you really enjoy. This is a podcast, little, you know, kind of me and you hanging out, talking about crafting and dyeing yarn and some spinning, which I haven't done any this week. You know, things that I've gotten, collaborations I'm working on, cool fiber-related fun stuff. Knitting, crochet, spinning. I craft a lot too, but I haven't really talked much about crafting and dyeing yarn. So if you're into that, just stay where you are, like right here, and we'll get into everything. At the end of the episode is when I like to do shop updates and particular things related to my shop. So if you want to see that, stick around till the end. And I also do personal stuff down toward the end, unless it's, I guess, relevant to something else. So I have a lot of things to talk about. Dyework, I have some questions related to dyeing. I have some acquisitions, some coming acquisitions, which I've touched upon a little bit last week. So let's just get into everything. Last week's shop update was awesome. So thank you everybody who came and supported the shop on Saturday. I had so many orders. My phone just kept going ching, 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 ching. Everybody grabbing up the pumpkin spice, which I was fully anticipating because I had a lot of people who are interested. So in response to that, I've been dyeing up more pumpkin spice this week on a couple of the bases. So this is in Everyday Sock. So isn't it so pretty? I love this. This was such a cool idea, and I'm so happy that everybody is liking it. But it was a really fun dye. So like, this is a tonal, and this is kind of like a speckledy tonal. This has a lot of, this has a bit more contrast than my first run of it. It's showing a little more vividly on screen than what I think it looks like in real life. I think it's a little bit more muted. And then this was like a dip dye ombre style. So it was fun to do a bunch of techniques on one set. So I'll have some sets up Saturday, but I just wanted to show like this is what I've been working on this week. I've had some custom orders come in this week, which has been really fun. Some mini skeins. So some mini skein dyeing that I've been doing. This is the set. This is the set that I've been working on this week. Brittany over at Lucky Rose Fibers asked me if I could do a custom mini skein set to go with her shop. And I was like, of course, why not? So I'll put a picture of her shop here. She runs Lucky Rose Fibers up in Wisconsin. And it's like this cool retro theme. So she has like this bubblegum pink and teal and like this silver like metal on her walls and then the black and white tile floor. So I was like, sure, I'll do that. So I thought this was really fun. Super sparkly. Those are headed off to her. And the latest dye that I was working on was actually one I did this morning, and I wanted to kind of talk about it just generally because, you know, this whole week has been like insane. It's been absolutely insane for me. My daughter has been sick. My son is now getting sick. He's sleeping. Yes, he's sleeping. And it's just been like the two of them at each other all week long. My husband's also been sick. So I'm the only one right now who's not sick. So it's been so chaotic. And I went to do this dye. The customer had me like postpone her shipping. And she said, can you just ship it on Friday? I don't want my husband to see. And that's totally fine. I'm totally fine with that. But it was for gradients. And gradients are a lot of work. I don't know if I've talked too much about gradients on this podcast, but I wanted to talk a little bit about the method of dyeing that happens with gradients and why gradients, like independently made gradients, are so much more expensive than you would think, or there's like an upcharge for the same base, you know, versus a tonal skein or a variegated skein, because it's so much more work, and especially if you don't buy pre-made blanks. So what happens for a gradient? So I'll show you what I've been working on. Text messages. Okay, so I have been working on some gradients this morning, and I knit up these blanks yesterday for a shipment that's supposed to go out today. These are very quick for me to dry. So what happens is I take the skein of yarn. This is a sock skein. So this is twice as long as I am tall as a total, will you stop texting me? I'm turning the volume down on this because I don't want all the text messages to bing, bing, bing. I also film on my phone, so okay, there we go. My ringer is silent. There we go. So this is taller than I am. It's a sock weight. This is the MCN base, the Luxe sock base. So when somebody is dyeing a gradient, either you can purchase sometimes pre-made sock blanks, which I'm sure you've seen painted up. Andre Sunitz does awesome painted sock blanks. Gina over at Beach Bum Yarns or the Rainy Apple Shop, I'll put some pictures here, of painted sock blanks. And those are just, you know, commercially knitted up, pre-made sock blanks that you can buy. And they're pretty expensive for us to purchase. So that's another reason why it's a little more expensive for a consumer, but I make my own blanks. So I've put up some videos before about knitting up blanks, like time-lapse videos that are about a minute long or so. And it takes me between 20 to 25 minutes to knit this blank. So take the yarn, put it in the knitting machine, and just knit. And if you follow me on Instagram, I was gonna kill my knitting machine this week, which is why these were getting knit up yesterday. So this is Weasley's Wizard Wheezes. So you'll see it goes from this dark kind of burnt orange or ginger color, kind of like their hair, all the way out to this lovely bright orange to like a peach, and then transitions into this plummy color, which is the color of the building for Weasley's Wizard Wheezes. So I did say Weasley. This is Weasley's Wizard Wheezes, right? It's not Gilderoy. I don't know what I said. My brain is like fried this week. So this is what happens when a gradient is made. This is a true gradient. This isn't like Karen Cakes. This isn't like something you'd buy at the craft store. I don't know how many commercially available like true gradients there are, but this is what a gradient looks like. So I knit this myself, wind out the yarn into a ball, knit it up on a knitting machine, then I dye it. So there are different ways you can achieve a gradient. You can hand paint them, you can kettle dye them, but this is what it looks like in its freshly dyed, freshly washed, waiting to be dried type form. But anyway, so this order that I stitched up, the supposed order, I didn't look at the order before I stitched it up because I thought I was smart enough to remember, it's Luck Sock and this is what she wanted and I'm gonna knit it up and just dye it. So that's what I did last night. I knit up the blanks that I thought she needed. And then this morning I went to dye them, and I dye this and it looks beautiful. And I put a picture of this while I was dyeing it on Instagram, but it came out really beautiful. I'm very pleased with this. There's only one tiny spot that had a little bit of not a dye boo-boo, but where like a little bit of dye didn't get fully absorbed. Now this is like a stitch in knitting that you probably won't even see. You know, when you knit it up, you probably won't see this, but it's a little boo-boo there, and this little one here. Sometimes that happens, but like, there's nothing I can do about it. I make sure my dyes are pretty well dissolved before I dye things, but this is very small. It's probably not going to show up on the knitting or crocheting when you're making your final piece. But anyway, so I dye this, and I'm like, oh, good, it's coming out great. I'm so happy with this, blah, 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 blah. Isn't that pretty? I go to dye the next one, which was supposed to be Gilderoy, which starts out as this nice, like, blue-toned purple. It's not as warm as this. See how much redder this is? This is more of a red tone. So this is purple tone, like a blue-toned purple. And it's coming out great. I'm like, oh, this is wonderful. Got my nice gradient going on. Beautiful. Now I'm going to switch colors. And now I'm going to dye me, who didn't look back at the recipe, who thought, I'm so smart. I know what I'm doing. I'm dyeing Gilderoy. And I pull the wrong blue out. I pull this blue. It's supposed to be this blue. I pull this blue out. And I dump it in the pot. And I'm dyeing. I'm like, this is coming out great. And then I'm thinking to myself, I'm like, Kayleen, this looks different. Why does this not feel right? This doesn't feel right. And I'm dying. And I'm getting a nice gradient. I'm like, oh, this gradient is coming out great. But for some reason, it's not feeling right to me. I'm like, is this not the right color? I thought this was the color. Oh no, it's not the right color. This is the wrong color blue for this gradient. So I have a whoopsie that's coming into the shop also, because I dyed it this color blue instead of this color blue. So, tips for new dyers. One, check your orders and double check and triple check before you start doing work on them, because you're a human being. Trick number two, check your dye recipes before you assume that you're remembering correctly what you should be doing. And number three, don't dye before you have your first morning cup of coffee, because that's what I did this morning. Big mistake. So Not only did I dye up this wrong color, I went back to my Etsy shop to check the order and realized that she wanted the DK weight of this base, not the sock weight. So not only did I dye the wrong weight, I dyed the wrong color on the colorway. So I'm going to have two gradients coming in the shop this weekend on the MCN sock base. One is Weasley's Wizard Wheezes with, you know, there's a couple dark spots in there, but they're so tiny it should make a difference. But it's going to be discounted anyway. So a nice discounted Weasley's Wizard Wheezes on my MCN base. And a discounted, whoopsie, this is not quite Gilderoy gradient. Oops. So now I have her blanks knitted up, which I have to dye up today, and she knows that I royally screwed it up. Cover your ears, foul language. I screwed it up. But she's not in a huge rush. She's kind of like, just chill out. I'm like, but I messed everything up. So yeah, that's been my dye week. I've been working on pumpkins all week. My kids have been sick. It's been this crazy. Like, is the moon full or something? Because my family is just, I'm out of my mind. So that's, did I just kick you? I think I kicked you. I'm sorry. So that's what I've been dyeing this week. In terms of crochet or knit, I have one hoe. It's almost a hoe in this bag, which is part of my acquisitions, which I'll get to in a minute. If anybody can guess who makes this bag, 5 points to Gryffindor for that. 5 points to your house of choice. But it's hiding in this little bag. And this, oh yeah, and then I have a finished object. This is my first mitt cast on, and I finally cast this baby on for the strings and more knit-along. So, the knit-along. I'm gonna start going Rhode Island on all y'all. So this is the tonal that I put out last week. This is the Mrs. Hudson tonal, which is very nice. It is on the MCN sock base of Luxe Sock. And I decided I wanted to try the Time to Reap mitts that Jamie has been working on because they look really cool and they didn't look too bad in terms of difficulty. So they have this lovely lace detailing that's here. I don't know if you can see it, looks like a chevron, up and down, up and down. I didn't mess it up. I dropped some stitches when I was doing lace here though. That's a better view. It's getting a little blown out because I'm so close to the camera. But I am past the thumb gusset, which was not a really big deal. It's out on some pumpkin waste yarn. And then I've started the top garter panel for the top of the mitts going into a lace repeat for the top of the mitts. So I've just finished a knit row. So I have a purl row, a knit row, purl row, then I start the lace repeats, and then I finish off with, I think, knit purl knit or something, another garter stitch panel. So it's coming out quite nicely. I've been called a ninja, which I'll get to also in the Ask Me Anything section. But I knit this up. This mitt is almost done, and I did it within a day. Like, you know, sitting down here and there just knitting it. Most of it is straight up stockinette. And, ouch, that hurt. So yeah, you can see it's probably going to end up being here, which is all right for me. I'm okay with that. If I'm thinking about, like, this panel, how big is it? It's probably going to end right at my knuckles here, which is totally fine. And then I have to knit up the thumb, which I'm not sure how to do yet. It says to pick up 3 stitches. 1, 2, 3, I guess, yeah, I could see where to pick them up. But I have to figure that out because I've never done that on a mitt before for knitting, picking up stitches. I had to do that on my sock that's in timeout. But yeah, I'm super happy about it. I was commenting on Facebook and I put a picture up and I'm like, I finally cast this on. Hashtag SM Mittalong. So if you look at the hashtag SM Mittalong, you'll see all the mitts that folks are working on for the Strings and More Mittalong. But I like it and I wear mitts, so I am happy to keep working on these. And it's so goddamn soft. Sorry, excuse my language. It's been a long week. It's so gosh darn soft. Like, I can't even. I just can't even. And this color is just baller. There's one of these left in the shop. There's one of these and one of the woman left. So if you haven't snagged one and you want one, you should go grab it. But this is a fun colorway. It's kind of a mauve, like a brownish mauve color. Very nice neutral. I'm certainly enjoying it. It's nice and warm. Warm, like, color, like, warm toned, and nice warm feeling. So, highly recommend. But that's my hoe. And then I do have a faux, which I don't even know if I feel like grabbing it. Maybe I will grab it. All right, I'll grab it. I'll be right back. Okay, so here's my finished object. Now, you'll recognize this yarn as the yarn I showed you last week. This is my hand spun. This is some commercial yarn here, by the way. But I finally crocheted up this danged pumpkin for the pumpkin cow that I was talking about. I'm going to be the pumpkin cow. I'm going to do mitts. I'm going to do this. I'm going to spin up this yarn. Well, all those glorious plans went down the toilet with my hand spun, which wasn't very good. So I had to figure out something I wanted to do with the hand spun. It was not enough hand spun to do a set of mitts. And I'm like, well, maybe I'll make a baby hat. So then I started this crochet project thinking I'm going to make a baby hat. So this is the top. You know, crochet hats are usually made from the top down. And I get, you know, down, and it's not very flexible. And I'm like, what am I going to do with this baby hat? I'm just going to make a baby hat just for fun. So I decided, well, why don't I just make this into a pumpkin? It's pumpkin-colored yarn, and I think it would make a cool pumpkin. So that's what I did. I made a sphere. So I had my increases, and then I had a row of just straight up half double crochet, and then I did my decreases at the same rate as I did my increases to make a sphere. And then I squished it, stuffed it. Cece helped me do it, and she said, I'm putting the lamb's tail in there. It's not lamb's tail, it was just polyfill, but she calls it the lamb's tail. So she said, I put all the lamb's tails in there. Yes, you did. Stuffed it up, made a little, like, just continued stitching the stem so it's just a cylinder. And then once I got to the top, I just, you know, kind of gathered the top together, because who's going to see or care anyway what it looks like. And then to make it more of a pumpkin-y feeling, I took some of the hand, I did this with the hand spun, with the extra tail. I like worked it in and around and just kind of like pulled in the sides to shape what I wanted to shape. And then I didn't like the definition, it wasn't defined enough, so I just took some commercial yarn that was like an orangey color and put that in the grooves so that when you see the pumpkin, it actually kind of looks like a pumpkin. So this is for Joanna of Stitching the High Notes and Gabby over at Once Upon a Corgi. They're doing the pumpkin cowl. If you haven't gone to that, you should go check it out because it's knit or crochet. You can spin stuff, but they say they want you to make stuff from your hand spun, which is totally fine, which is what I did. So that's my finished object. This is my hoe. Now for acquisitions, and I'm going to go through those because there are several. So I told you guys last week that I was buying bags, bag lady over here, and that I was going to be getting some stitch markers, and so those came. There's still a shipment of stitch markers, which I'll put a little preview over here. That's coming from Lori. My good friend Lori from college, she's one of my best friends, and she's a lampwork bead artist and a glass blower, and she's now making stitch markers, and I'm like, give them to me. So they're coming to me, and they may or may not be in new shipments. Once they arrive, they might, you know, one might just drop in there for you. I'm definitely going to do some kits, but this is my bag. This is one bag I bought. This is from You So and So. So let me see if I have her card. So this is Sarah from You So and So, and she included this cute little pin. I think it's a pin, or maybe it's just a wooden sheep. I didn't open it. I thought maybe, oh, it's a pin. Oh no, it's a button. It's a button. Get out, Sarah. You're insane. You're insane. This is so cute. So this is a little sheep button that she included. This is her business card, You Sew and Sew. She has an Etsy shop. And her bags are just freaking adorable. Like, I love these bags. You can't really read it. Tapers Crow. Yeah, you can't really read it. So I'll just pop her information down below. But her 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 Etsy shop. Oh no, it's not an Etsy shop. This week has been so hard. She has a website, which is yousoandso.com. And you can earn reward points with her if you order bags all the time from her, which is great. She updates, I think, once a week. But she's on Instagram, and I follow her. And I've been following her for quite some time. And I have to say that Shanna and Jamie, you are enablers of the worst kind or the best kind. Because I saw this in her shop update, and I'm like, I need this right now. So this is my very first You So and So bag. It will not be my last because this is very high quality. So here's a cute little tag, You So and So, a little sheep. But these are trees. And I was in such a fall mood. I'm like, I need this bag. She includes a little sheep charm as a zipper pull. I did add my fox here. This was one from Knitty by Nature she sent to me. So inside it has a Living My Knits, and then inside it's this pretty fox fabric, and there's deer, I think, on it. It's like woodland creatures. Yeah, there's some, let's see the animals that are on here. Let's see if I can get a good shot. Yeah, so there's like a deer and a fox. I think there's some like chipmunks, there's a bunny. But it's so pretty, and it's so up my alley. I love these colors, and I love the look and feel of this bag. I was a little worried about the shape because I really like a bag to be able to be opened, like fully opened, and like have enough room to like see what's going on. But you can definitely open it up. And I'd say this is a 2-skein maximum bag, like a small project, two skein small project bag. Okay, so see, it even opens up very well. So I was all worried about the shape. I'm like, oh, maybe the shape won't be that great, but I actually kind of like it. So yeah, definitely recommend. That was purchase number one, and that was a selfish purchase. Purchase two was over at Molly Klein Design. Big surprise. I love Molly, she is so sweet. And she had a shop update, and I put a comment on a bag, this llama bag that I really wanted, and I honestly just totally forgot about it. You know, one of those things where you're like, oh my God, I need that. I'll take a look on Friday when I get paid, or when I have the funds available to make a purchase. And so I made a comment. I'm like, oh, I need this llama bag. And it was like a week and a half later, and she commented and tagged me, and she's like, Kayleen, there's still one available. Do you want it? You should come get it. So of course I like ran over to her shop early morning, and I'm like, I'm gonna buy a bunch of bags. So I am going to keep this llama bag. This is mine. Get out of town. Look at the llamas. Llama, llama, llama. So this is beautiful. Here's Molly's little tag, Molly Klein Design. And then, like, this is metallic. I don't know how much you guys can tell this is metallic. This is silver metallic and teal. Hello. This llama print with mama llamas, daddy llamas, and baby llamas. And then on the inside is this cool, like, blue checkered fabric. And it is the cutest thing ever. So this is always the first thing I do when I check a bag, is to see how well does it stand. You know, it stands pretty well on its own. It probably could use a nice ball of yarn in there. But I think you could fit, I'd say 2 max. This is maybe a 2 maximum skein bag. It's a very similar size to this bag. I think it has more vertical room. Yeah, just a very, it's maybe a little narrower, but a little bit taller. So I was so excited to get my hands on this because this was the last one. Sorry, guys, it's mine. But as always, she always puts extra things, which I'll show you in a second. But the other bags that I purchased, I want to make little gift sets out of. So this is a Starry Night bag, which is obviously Starry Night, Van Gogh. And on the inside, it's this lovely, it's kind of like black and green. It almost looks like a painting inside, but it's like flowers, I think, but it has a very similar feel to what's on the outside in terms of palette. So that's one that's going to be made into a kit. I got two of these, which I might get more of the Exploding TARDIS because, oh, Dr. Who. So this is the Exploding TARDIS. Inside is this cool paisley print. But it's a generously sized bag. Definitely enough for one, possibly two skeins on a small project. I'm pretty sure these are both the same, yeah. They're both the same on the inside. And then the last bag I got, which is this, I think would be nice for a pair of socks. It's a little wider, I think. No, same size, a little shorter. So I'd say this is a one skein type bag, but this is a Halloween print. Look at that, isn't that so cool? And it's got purple and orange on the inside. It's kind of, I'm sorry, it's black and orange flowers. So it's very cute, very cute. So these bags, the two Tardi bags, this Halloween bag, and this Van Gogh bag, I think are all gonna be made into little kits. So I'm gonna dye up some coordinating yarn, which may or may not be one of a kind. We'll see how that goes. Maybe a little anarchy for these. But I have a color in mind for the TARDIS bags because Doctor Who. So she included, these were in my order. Then she included a sheet of stickers for my daughter, which thank you very much, Molly. Cece is already obsessed with these stickers and I have to tell her not to touch them because she has so many other stickers. But then she included some chai tea, which is so lovely. My husband loves chai. And some pink lemonade, which I love. And then some zesty orange soap, which has a delicious smell. Like, I love oranges. So I was so excited to get this little soap. Oh, it smells so good. It's like that refreshing smell. So that's what I got from Molly. Oh wait, there's more. I did more purchasing. Bad me. Jesus. You see my box, my diaper box? That's my work in progress, my yarn work. So like as I'm doing these little mini sets, I'm like tossing them in the box so that I have them all together. Mom life right there. Okay, so then my last purchase was from Miss Melissa over at Knitty by Nature. And let me just say, you win like top prizes for your packaging. Like, it is so cute. So cute. Like, what a cute little gift box. And like, you can reuse this. Well, you can store your notions in here if you want. Maybe put a piece of Velcro here so that it kind of has a little stick. So you could store your notions in this. This is how it came. You open it up. Look at that, a little tissue paper and her business card. So she included a couple of extra charms for me, which are, you know, way to a woman's heart. So this little yarn. And she gave me a golden snitch. Look at that. I'm so stoked for that progress keeper. Look at it, it's a little bell and it does dingle. I don't know if you can hear that, but it does dingle. So then I ordered a bunch of stitch markers. Again, in thoughts of maybe some for myself, but also some to include in kits. So I ordered some Halloween ones. So there's like a ghost and a pumpkin and a bat and an owl here. So some cute, these are all progress keepers. Or you can use them as stitch markers too, but more for progress keepers. These are all stitch markers, so I ordered a set of these Deathly Hallows, if I can get them undone. These Deathly Hallows, it's a set of three. Oh my gosh, come out, there we go. It's a set of three stitch markers, proper stitch markers, knit stitch markers, snaggy, free, but Deathly Hallows, which I think I'm gonna use the bag that I traded with Georgianne for, that Gryffindor bag, and I think I'm gonna make a little gift set with these stitch markers and that bag, and I think that would be really cute. So then I have some more here. This is a teapot and a teacup and a tea bag. And then these, this set is like a fox, a sheep, a padlock, and like a Celtic knot, and a four-leaf clover. And then this one is a yin and yang, a Buddha, a sheep, a lock, and a fox. So it's just some little trinkets to keep your progress on your project. So yeah, I'm very excited for these. So you'll probably see some of these coming up in some sets. These for the Halloween. I think I'm gonna pair these with the Halloween bag and then include, and then do like one of my Halloween colorways, maybe the dark mark, and include it like as a whole set for these. Because it's so awesome. Like, how cool is that? Plus, I just love ideas, and I just come up with all these ideas, and I'm just like, wow, I can just totally do that, right? Can I? And then I go spend all the money. So yes, and then also Lori's gift set. Lori's stitch markers will probably be included in gift sets as well in the future, because I love that kind of stuff, and her stitch markers are just gorgeous. Like, they are so, like, spot on. All right. So we are half hour in. Hopefully I don't need too much editing on this and I can get it up this week before Cece gets picked up from preschool. But I did want to do my Ask Me Anything portion because I love that section. It gives you guys a chance to interact with me. Alright, text messages. Everybody stop messaging me. Did you hear that, everybody? Alright, so I haven't asked me anything that I always solicit for. I have a couple new people in the podcast group. So welcome to everybody who is new here. Scrap Girl TC, welcome to the group, and Stitching Plaza, which is Georgian, welcome to the group, and Susanna 76, welcome to the group, and Corona 2, welcome to the group, and P. Yoder, welcome. Welcome. Some of you guys I recognize from other places, but welcome. So there's no questions here in Ravelry, so I will check on Facebook. I did post in a couple places, obviously on my own page, and then I cross-posted to some other yarn groups that I'm in, which I do every week, so if you know me, and you've seen me around in yarn groups, keep your eyes peeled on podcast day, because I almost always post up a, I almost always cross post my Ask Me Anything, because I really want to get to know you guys, and I want you to get to know me a little bit, or if you have questions about, you know, being a dyer, or being a mom, or yarn, crochet, knitting, whatever, I'm happy to entertain it all. So, all right, I do have some questions. Questions. Okay, that's enough. I like filming on Fridays because things get a little gray. I don't have to take myself too seriously. I'm not like constantly listening for the kids. This is nice. I enjoy this. If you enjoy this, like and subscribe. You should. Okay, so in Facebook, Dawn Von S. Brown, she asks me, what are some of the challenges or doubts you had to overcome as a dyer or fiber artist? That is a really good question. That is a question that could be its own video, I think. Challenges to overcome. I would say the biggest one is myself. So I am my own limiting factor when it comes to crafting and, you know, dyeing and crocheting and stuff like that. So I've been crocheting for so long that it's almost not fun for me, but it's a little bit, you know, it's humdrum. Everything feels the same. You know, I look at a hat or I look at a pattern, like how many requests? I got so many requests from friends and family to make these crocodile stitch gloves. Not that I don't want to make these gloves, but I don't have much time. But I look at a pattern like that and I'm like, oh, that's what this is. And then this is a crocodile stitch and I don't even really need the pattern. I can just make it. And I feel bad for saying that because, you know, a lot of time and effort goes into working up a pattern and making a pattern. But like, I'm not excited about crochet anymore. Most of the time I'm not jumping off the edge of my seat when a new crochet pattern comes out, with the exception of Mama Chi Crochet Designs. Anything she puts out, I'm like, holy crap, I need to crochet the heck out of that. But it's because her designs are so different than other crocheters. But the challenges or doubts that I have, it really is my own mentality. One, there's some boredom that goes in where I'm just like, oh yeah, I'll do this. And then I get really bored with it, especially with crochet. And then two, it's like, I limit myself. Rewind. When I was doing, you know, my parenting channel and, you know, I became a mom and I'm still crocheting and then I'm like, oh, I'll make some teething rings and, oh, that's really fun for a while and I'll consign and da da da. Sorry, there's a car starting up out there. And then, like, I started thinking about other things I can do. Well, maybe I can knit. And, you know, I've picked up and put down knitting at least 7 or 8 times in my lifespan of, like, doing stuff in the fiber world. I'm sorry about the car, by the way. You know, in 20 years, just about 20 years, next year will be 20 years that I've been crocheting, I've picked up knitting 7 or 8 times. And I'm like, I was never that into it. I was kind of like, oh, whatever. I can just do this in crochet. I could just make some crochet stuff that looks like that. And like, it was me limiting myself because really, you can do anything you put your mind to. If you have an idea in your head, fiber-wise, say like you want to learn how to knit and you're a crocheter. I always use that example because that was me and I can identify with that. But if you're a crocheter like me and you want to learn how to knit, you can do it. You can do that. You totally can. It's a matter of finding something that's comfortable for you and that is enjoyable, that makes the process worthwhile. For me, the purling step was always the limiting point for me. I'm like, I can't do that. Or throwing English style. I could never do that. And I think every single time that I tried to knit, I was going at it kind of half-heartedly. Because I always had it in my mind, well, you don't like doing that, so you probably can't do it anyway. So I'd say myself, like me, I am my own biggest challenge because I put these ideas in my head, like, you know, those doubty things. No, you can't do it. Or you didn't like it last time, so what makes you think you're going to like it this time? And I have to, like, put a damper on that and say, you know what? If I want to do it, I'm just going to do it. And I'm going to go full in on it. I'm going to find a way that makes me comfortable. Like, I'm too old now. I hate saying that because I'm only 32, but like, I'm too old now. I'm at this point in my life where I just want to do it and have fun and find things that I enjoy because I enjoy crochet to a point. There are some times where I get burned out, but you know, but you can do it. Like, find a way that makes you feel comfortable. Are you a knitter that wants to learn to crochet? You can do it. You just have to find something that calls to you, something that makes you say, and the light switch goes off and you say, like, I can. So that's my biggest piece of advice to anybody who's like looking to learn crochet, to learn to knit, to learn to dye, to craft, to create, to sew. If you want to do it, just do it. Don't worry about what other people have to say to you. Whether you're a guy or a girl, it doesn't matter. Do whatever you want. If it makes you happy inside, if the thought of it and you're like, oh, I just want to sew a bag, then go sew a bag. It's the best time to do it. Don't let your own thoughts get in the way of that. If you're drawn to it and you're like, you're called to do something, then just do it. That's exactly what I did with dyeing. Dyeing was an idea I had one day. I'm sitting at home and I'm like, I am tired of this and I am tired of that. And I don't want to keep doing this anymore. And I don't want to keep buying this particular product anymore. And I just want to do it myself. And so I looked up how to do it. I taught myself how to do it. I contacted other dyers and other people to kind of get advice. And, you know, not everybody can do everything, but if it's something that makes you happy, just do it. Like, I started doing this just for fun. Like, just for my own benefit, to make pretty things, pretty colors that I would like to stitch with. And it turned into something much more for me, which is fine, excuse me. But, like, if you have some food dye at home and some vinegar and some bare wool and you want to dye it, just dye it and have fun doing it and make something cool and creative and fun. So that's really the doubts that I had. I always put myself down in terms of things. Like, it's so weird. We're getting really personal here. So I have not always had the best self-esteem for myself personally. And, but I'm always a person who has to be busy and like doing something, and I take on a lot of things. So, but it doesn't stop the thoughts from coming or saying like, oh, you know, why are you doing this? You're so stupid. Or why would you think you could do something like that? People are going to judge you. And so it's like, that's the best piece of advice that I can give is just, if you feel like you like something and you feel like you want to do it, just give it a shot. Find a way that it's comfortable for you to do, as long as you're not hurting someone or yourself. Like, if you want to knit, learn to knit. Find a way that makes you comfortable. Go take a class and don't worry about what other people think of you. I was crocheting at 13. I got so much flack from my peers for being an old lady, or I was crocheting, so that meant I was uncool. If you want to do it, just do it. Don't let yourself be the limit. So that's all I have to say about that. Now that I got all personal and weird. So then I know my husband asked me another question, which he's so cute. He asked me on my Facebook page, and I know the question, but I have to read it so that I don't mess it up. The question, he said, what made you want to start dyeing yarn? So I touched upon that in my second episode, but really the biggest motivation for me to want to dye yarn was really I was looking for something to do. And I didn't want to just keep crocheting because I get very bored with crochet because I've been doing it for so long, which is what I just said, like for the last question. And I didn't like the yarn that I got from the craft store at all. And I hated variegated yarns from the craft store. And he knows, like, he knows what's in that cupboard in the guest room. Like, he knows the volume of yarn that I have. And so I started doing commission work for a photographer, and I was like, this is great, this is so nice. And I was doing some commission work with a children's boutique. Cars and crying babies, that's what my life is like right now. Which was really fun too, and I was doing some teething rings, which was really kind of fun. But that turned into this whole thing, and like, I stopped doing the teething rings because it needs all of this extra testing and stuff that I was like, I don't want to go through all that just to sell teething rings, so I'm not going to do that. And so it was pretty much like I wanted to try and fill a need for myself as like a person, you know, to make myself feel a little more fulfilled in my life, because with kids you kind of lose yourself a little bit. You know, you have your kids and everything revolves around them. Every single bit of your life becomes part of, like, their life becomes part of your life, and it's easy to not keep a piece of you there, because you are a servant to your children. You are the one, I know there's no better, I don't know if there's a better word for it. I mean, you're being a parent. Everything that you are, you're putting into the world for them, like making their lives better. And you are teaching them and you're caring for their needs. And it's from the time you get up until the time you go to bed. And sometimes it's all through the night. So it was for me for that. And then also as a crocheter, the frustration I felt as a crocheter being in this craft world with a bunch of knitters, like, and the yarns that are in the craft store, I didn't like them. I didn't like the color changes. I didn't like how they were. I didn't enjoy stitching with them. I didn't enjoy the material. And so I was like, well, why couldn't I dye my own yarn? Especially long transitions, like gradients. this was part of the reason why I wanted to dye my own yarn, because I wanted to be able to do something like this. So I wanted to fill that need, not only for myself, but for other crocheters who are out there who feel limited by the craft store and who felt like I feel about certain types of yarn or whatever. And I thought it would give me a chance to not only grow as a person is taking on this hobby, which has now become my business, and help me grow as a person and help me grow as a creator and a creative person, because that's who I am. I am a creative person. I always have to be doing things, and I like exploring different avenues of crafting. And I did ceramics, I did glass blowing, I've done drawing, I've done painting, crochet, knitting. Like, I like to do it all. I like to try my hand at everything, because I feel like, even though I doubt myself, I know I can do anything. Like, if I want to do it, I'm going to do it, and I'm going to do it well. That's what I have to keep pushing myself to think. So part of dyeing yarn, I feel so bad. He does not feel good. Part of dyeing yarn was that, where I wanted to maybe even prove to myself that I could do it. Be like, you could do that. You should do it. Yep, you should do that. You're going to do that. And I jumped in with both feet, and I just ran with it. And I have so much fun doing it, and it allows me to be creative in a flexible way where I can do this work at home. You know, my kids can be around, obviously not in the kitchen while I'm dying, but, you know, I can do things like this at home, make a little extra money, which most of it all gets put back into the business, but like to feel useful in another way, aside from just being a mom, and also to fill a need for me as a crocheter and for other crocheters and crafters out there who don't know that things like this exist. You know, that's part of the reason why I started the podcast too, was because I was doing my parenting stuff and I felt a little, you know, uninspired by it. And I was like, well, what if I started doing this and started sharing things like this on YouTube, and other people do this also. And like, I was not aware of this whole podcasting world, so to speak. So it was very interesting to start that and do that. So anyway, that's long the short of it. I wanted to do it for myself, and I wanted to do it to fill a need in the crafting community, and I wanted to do it because it was fun and because I thought I could do it, and so I do it. That's why. All right, so I'm gonna move on to Instagram. I have more questions here. All right, so Miss Caroline, Miss Inspired _ Professor, has asked me more questions this week. So she said, first I'll comment and then I'll ask. You are a novice knitter, which I kind of am a novice knitter. I've only just really started knitting. Yet I saw some ninja knitting with your mittens this week. One day they were cast on, the next they were half done. Although I never saw your finished socks. Those are in timeout. You've got 2 toddlers, a business, you podcast, and I would guess you tend to your house. And hubby gets some sleep every once in a while. My question is, how do you do it all? Please share some ideas about your time management strategy and how to avoid burnout and breakdowns. I sincerely admire you and others out there. Thank you for all that you guys get done with your time. Well, thank you. That is very complimentary. I feel very happy to do stuff like this. He's fussy. I feel really bad. He's really congested and like, there's nothing I can do for him except put pillows in his bed and hope that he sleeps. But anyway, so how do I do it all? Please share ideas about time management strategy. Okay, so I don't know. So I forgot how hard it is to like film on the ground, because you have to get up and get down, get up and get down. What was I saying? So when I worked a traditional job, I worked as a research coordinator for a lab in Boston at Spalding Rehab, very large international laboratory with 20 plus research studies. So I was lab manager / research coordinator, but I was the person for this whole lab. I managed all the international research fellows. I did personal work for my PI. I did like paper editing, like pretty much copy editing for a lot of the papers that he was releasing. And then I also manage all the research studies, including all of the IRB, International Institutional Review Board reviews for all the research. So I was the person to write the studies, like to write up the methodology. Like they would give me an outline and pretty much an idea. They would do a lot of the scientific research, but then I would bolster it and make it presentable for the institution. So it was a very busy, stressful, crazy job, but I loved every minute of it because I was always busy. I was the person everyone relied on. I could help anyone with anything. I could train anybody in anything. I was always available. I was the one to be the person. And so it's like that in my personal life, being a parent, you know, you are that person for your kids. And so my family always comes first, and I always try to put the kids go first, and then my husband, and then me, and then the housework. So I just try and take on what I can take on. I know my limits personally. I'm a pretty introspective person, so I'm always kind of gauging where am I at, how am I mentally, you know, what's my workload like, am I taking on too much? And so I like to take on things as much as I can, and then when I'm at my limit, I back off, and I try not to push myself over my limit. And if I'm at a limit, I don't have a problem saying, like, I'm at my limit. So yes, I podcast. I take advantage of nap times. That's pretty much my time management, is I really try and take advantage. Sorry, I keep looking at the monitor to make sure he's okay. I take advantage of the time that I'm given. So a minute lost is a minute wasted for me. So I have to take advantage of every minute that I have available to me so that I can do everything that I want to do and everything that I need to do. I'm not much of a chef. I don't cook. I cook for the kids as much as I need to cook for the kids. Everything's pretty basic. I'm not the best housekeeper. I keep my workspace clean and I keep things generally clean, but we usually clean at night after the kids go to bed. You know, vacuuming and all that stuff. But my husband is much more OCD than I am about cleaning. And, you know, my marriage, I have to take care of my marriage, and being in a relationship, it's a partnership, and my husband and I very much view it that way. So we support each other, and we're open and honest and caring toward each other, and we just talk about everything, you know, how we're feeling, how our day's going. My husband is totally in and on board on this whole yarn dyeing experience because it's on me and I'm capable to manage my own business. But, you know, that's how we do it. You have to know your limit personally. You have to know what you're capable of and what your limitations are. You know, you don't want to go over that. I'm not going to go up to a shop and say, yeah, I'll wholesale order you 500 skeins of a gradient by next week. Like, I can't do that. I can't. So I will never take on something that I cannot handle. So I'm good at knowing that. So that's probably my best bit of advice of this whole entire ramble, is to know your limits and know what you can do or can't do. Like these mitts that I started them at night after the kids went to bed. I cast on, I worked on them for, I don't know, an hour, got to the mitt part. Then the next day we went out to the playground and I brought them to the playground, and while the kids played, I knit all the way. I finished all the thumb gusset increases and put the thumb on waist yarn. And then when we got back, my son was asleep in the car, and then my mother-in-law came to pick up my daughter for just to go for a walk. And so while my son was napping, I didn't want to wake him up, so I sat on a diaper box that was in my car. The diaper box. I have tons of diaper boxes around the house. But the diaper box was in my car, and I sat in the diaper box, and I knit from the thumb gusset to here. And then that night, I just did a couple repeats of the garter stitch. So it's not inconceivable. I don't sit for hours and hours knitting. I knit relatively quickly, I guess. But I guess I'm just a ninja wizard mermaid. That's the answer. but yes, there you go. So FiberAddict71 on Instagram also asked me a dye question. She said, can't wait to watch, and thank you for answering my questions a few episodes back. You're very welcome. I'm always happy to answer. I'm about to attempt to dye skein of yarn with stellina. I've heard that it's best to use vinegar instead of citric acid, and my question is how much vinegar would be efficient without messing up the stellina content. So here's the deal. I've never had a problem with using citric acid with stellina. I use citric acid primarily. I rarely ever use vinegar unless I have to. So these were dyed with citric acid. This is the darkest, deepest, most dyed skein. Was the black. I don't know if I have another black that's not in a package, but it's easier to see stellina on darker colors because it's darker. It's easier to photograph. But these are all stellina. And I have not had a problem with the citric acid dulling the stellina. I guess if you're using a ton of citric acid, or I don't know what would make the citric acid dull the stellina. I don't know the chemistry behind, like, the acidity of the water. I know that stellina, if you over dye your yarn, like if you saturate the yarn to a point where, like, it can't absorb any more, the stellina will start to absorb the dyes, and it will tint the stellina a color. So all of these are stellina too. So this skein, this is aubergine. You can see that, I mean, it's still stellina, and you can see it, but the stellina is a little bit tinted because the saturation was so high in the pot, it saturated some of the stellina. But it's still there, and you can still see it. I guess you can just use, I don't know the proportions of vinegar to, like, pounds of fiber, like, what you'd be dyeing. But you can start, like, I'd say start with a couple of tablespoons, like 2 to 3 tablespoons of vinegar. And then if that's enough to set the dye, then just go from there. If it's not enough to set the dye, like, you've dyed it, and then you go to wash it and all the dye is rinsing out, then up your vinegar. You could always do, like, a pH test in your water to see how acidic it is for the dyes that you're using. So if you put a couple tablespoons of vinegar and, like, maybe a few gallons of water, you know, take a little pH, a test strip to see the acidity of the water, and then you can go from there. But I have not had a problem with citric acid and stellina. There are some dyers who swear by using vinegar and some that use citric acid. I'd say use whatever you'd like, as long as it makes the water acidic. Okay, that is the last question. This is a little bit of a longer episode, I suppose. So yeah, that's about it. I don't really have much else to talk about except for a shop update. So if you are interested in hearing about the shop update for tomorrow, then stick around. And if not, I'll see you next time. I hope you enjoyed this episode. And if you have questions for me, please feel free to leave them in the comments below. You can leave them on Facebook, Instagram, you can message me on Etsy, or you can leave them in the Ravelry group for the Little Bean and Me podcast, which is also linked below. So as far as shop update is concerned, it's a little bit of a mishmash this week because I have been focusing on dyeing some pumpkin spice. This is the last dye I think I'm going to do for this colorway for this season. Unless there's a huge need for it, if people are really wanting the pumpkin spice. So this is coming up a lot more saturated on screen than it is in real life. I don't know if it's because of, like, the background or whatnot. It's saturated, but, like, I feel like it's much more vivid on the screen right now. Yeah, that's showing up pretty true. I don't know why this one's showing up a little bit. Well, I mean, it is saturated, but, like, I feel like it's showing up way more orange here. So anyway, so this is what I've been dyeing up. I'm going to have some sets up on the, this is Everyday Sock. I have some sets that are going up on the Luxe sock base. And then I have some sets going up on the Simple DK base. I still have to dye those, but they're not going to ship out until Monday. So all orders. So the shop update, let me just say this. Shop update is tomorrow. The shop update is tomorrow, which is Saturday at 1 p.m. Eastern Time. I do ship internationally. I tried to pick a time that was good for most people. It's on a weekend. It's kind of in the middle of the day. It's pretty good for European folks who are interested in getting stuff. So it'll be at 1 p.m. Eastern Time tomorrow. And I'm going to have some pumpkin spice sets. I'm getting a yarn delivery today with some mini skeins. I'm going to dye up some more mini skein Halloween candy sets because right now they're all out. I had some requests from folks who wanted some mini skeins, so I'm going to do that. And then I'm going to have these gradients in the shop. This one is Gilderoy. So this goes from, these are the darker ends, so this is like a rusty color. And that's a plum color, and it all fades a bit lighter. It's around a 50-50 split. I think there's a little more orange than purple. Sorry. So this is the gradient. I'll kind of wrap it up so you can see the color change. So you can see how well this... I say you can see a lot, and my battery is going to die any moment, so there's the purple, and there's the orange. So that's Weasley's Wizard Wheezes. I called this Gilderoy again. My brain. And then this is not quite Gilderoy. So all the trucks decided they wanted to drive down my street today, by the way. So here it is. It goes from a deep, kind of like a peacock blue, into a light purple, into a dark purple. This is more of a blue-toned purple. I think this looks pretty. I like it, but it wasn't the intended colorway. This is also going up on the shop update. So that's that gradient. And then I have this mini skein. So I have two pumpkin spice mini skein sets that are going to go up in the shop. So it's just three mini skeins, everyday sock, blend, pumpkin spice, and latte. Which they'll probably, I think I'm going to repackage them like this. Because this is a little more compact. I feel like this will stay better, you know, wherever, if you're storing it, you can put it on your shelf. It's not going to get as loose as this, I suppose. I don't know. Let me know. What do you prefer? This little shorty set where it's a little double wrapped, or do you like them all long and dangly? Maybe that's a personal question. woo! So that's the end. I don't really have much else to talk about. I might have some of these. I might have a couple sets up in the shop for the exploding TARDIS bag, but I'm not sure if I'm gonna have time to do that. But any orders placed tomorrow will be shipped on Monday, and that's all. So that's the end of it. We're in about an hour. That's not too bad. Oh my god, get off my foot. You know when your foot falls asleep and it goes numb? It's the worst. Because then when it wakes up, it's the worst. So, yes. If you liked this video and you'd like to see more, give me a thumbs up below so I know. If you have comments or questions, you're always free to leave them in the comments section below. You can leave them here. You can leave them on Ravelry. I also cross-post this to Ravelry. If you have questions or comments for me personally with regard to my shop, you can send me a message on Etsy or Instagram. I get those messages blink on my phone. And yeah, if you're not subscribed and you'd like to be and you'd like to see more of me and this weird awkwardness, you can subscribe. The button is down below. And that's all. I hope you have a lovely weekend. If you're coming to the shop update, I hope you get what you came for. No carjacking. Somebody got carjacked last week and I was so upset about it. So I bet more than one person got carjacked, but one person told me she got carjacked and it was on a one-of-a-kind color, and I'm like, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. So sorry about that. That's all. It's like the 20-minute goodbye. Goodbye, 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 goodbye. Have a lovely week, and I will talk to you next time.